Hi, how are you? Today the topic of discussion is nutrition assessment. So, what is nutrition assessment? It is a measurement of nutritional status by different means like anthropometrics, biochemical or clinical data, and dietary history, etc. Nutritional status is the health status that produced by balanced diet requirements and intake. Before discussing the nutritional assessment methods, it's important to know why we do nutritional assessments. Point number one is to identify individuals or population groups that are at risk of becoming malnourished. These groups may be children or old people or pregnant women. So there are a lot of groups in the community, and which group is at risk? We want to identify that group by doing the nutritional assessment. The other point is to identify individuals or population groups who are malnourished. In first point, we want to identify that individuals or groups that are at risk of becoming malnourished. While second point says that the people who are malnourished. So, 2 points are who are at risk and the other one who are malnourished. Then, to define the nutritional problem of the targeted population. Now, we identify that this group is malnourished or at risk of becoming malnourished. Now, what type of malnourishment is there in specific group which we identified? To develop healthcare programs that meet the community needs which are defined by the assessments. Now we know about the group who is at risk of becoming malnourished or who is malnourished, and we also know by nutritional assessment that what type of deficiency, any type of deficiency is present in that group. By using this information, we develop the programs to recover that malnutrition. And then to measure the effectiveness of the nutritional programs and interventions once initiated. Then we compare the previous data and the recent data of nutritional assessment, and we see that either our intervention which we done to treat the malnutrition is successful or not. So in short, define needs, opportunities and constraints and prioritize solution. So that's the reason we do nutritional assessment. Now let's see one by one which are the methods of nutritional assessment. So nutritional assessment can be done by direct method or by indirect method. Direct method are commonly used in social sciences, in sociology, anthropology, in food and nutrition, in public health. So community-based research is based on the direct methods. The list of direct methods is anthropometric methods, biochemical and laboratory methods, clinical methods, dietary evaluation or assessment methods, and energy balance. We see one by one all of these, what are they and how we can measure these. The second is indirect method. We not directly assess the nutritional status, but we can assume with these variables that the nutritional status of that community or population would be normal or not. So uses community health indicators that reflects nutritional influences. Examples are ecological variables such as crop production, similarly soil fertility, food import and export, and staples production, etc. Then economic factors, per capita income, population density and social habits, vital health statistics, particularly infant mortality and under 5 mortality and fertility index. Different types of mortality we see in this type of assessment. Neonatal mortality, maternal mortality, infant mortality, under 5 mortality, and such indicators. we will discuss direct methods in detail, but not the indirect methods. So first is anthropometric method. It is the most common used method in clinics as well as in social science researches. What we do in that method, we measure the body height, weight and proportions, and it is used to evaluate both under and over nutrition, and that is the reason it's most important method, it's most common method and most cost effective method. In anthropometric methods, what we can measure, the body mass index, we can calculate BMI, its short term is BMI. Then we can measure the mid arm circumference, skin fold thickness, head circumference, head and chest ratio, hip or waist ratio. In listed methods, body mass index is the most commonly used method for adults, and for children, we commonly measure the mid arm circumference and head circumference. Instruments are available for measuring these methods, measuring strips which you can see in the background of this screen. These are used for measuring these methods, weight machine and all measuring strips. So for calculating body mass index, there is a formula. We take the weight of person in kilograms and height in meters, and by using this formula we calculate the BMI of a person. So there are various categories of BMI on the basis of which we can say that the person is normal, healthy, or he is malnourished. Malnourishment may be under nutrition or over nutrition. So we can measure both type of malnourished status by using the BMI formula. And you can see that 18.5 to 24.9 is the healthy weight range. Less than 18.5 is considered as underweight, while more than 25 is overnourishment, which is further divided into three categories. 25 to 29.9 BMI is considered as overweight, then 30 to 39.9 is obesity, and more than 40 is severe obesity. When we see the advantages of anthropometric method, then it's a precise, accurate and inexpensive method. Readings are numerical. BMI, for example, we say the BMI of that person is 19, or you can say 24 or 25 point something. So these are all numeric data. It uses standardized technique. Then readings are reproducible. Today my BMI is 24.5, then tomorrow I can calculate it again and there will be no difference. Non-expensive and need minimal training. One time you buy the instrument and then you can use it on numerous people. Suitable for large sample size. In community-based studies, we take the sample size of 100, 400, more than 400. So, it's the easiest way to take the measurements. Representative population sample. In one community, if we take the sample of 100 or 400, depending on the population of that community, then we can generalize our results. There are some limitations of this method, which are inter-observer errors in measurement. Let's suppose I am observer, I am taking the height of a person and I am doing mistake in taking the height in measurements. So there will be difference in height in 1 inch, 2 inch, 3 inch. I am not taking it correctly by adopting the correct techniques. Then it's the inter-observer error. And it can occur. Limited nutritional diagnosis. Yes, we can see that the person is overnourished or malnourished, but we can't identify what type of nourishment is this. we can't specify the nutrient, either it's a vitamin deficiency or which specific vitamin deficiency or which specific mineral deficiency. We can't identify such type of deficiencies, but we can identify that it's malnourished or undernourished. Problems with reference standards, for example, local versus international standards. Some standards vary according to the geographical area, and these may be different. So, results of one community or one population or one geographical area, we can't generalize it to the other community, other population, or other geographical area. So, these are the limitations of anthropometry method. Second is clinical methods. These are used on the clinics. These are simplest and most practical method. In clinical methods, we see the signs and symptoms, and then general clinical examination with special attention to organs like hair, gums, nails, skin, eyes, tongue, muscles, bones, and thyroid glands. In this method, we take the medical history of the patient, treatment, if the patient received previously, and what type of medication he received earlier. So, by keen observation of the organs, of the mentioned organs, we can assume what type of deficiency the patient has. The advantages, it's a fast and easy to perform. You can say it's a simple observation. We observe, and then inexpensive, so no money is required, and then non-invasive. But what is the limitation? Did not detect early cases. For example, a person is calcium deficient. On his nails, the symptoms not appear until he is chronic deficient of the calcium. We talked about gums, about hairs. The structure of these organs not changed until the patient is chronic deficient of the specific minerals, of the specific vitamins. So, it's a big limitation of this method that we did not detect early cases. Third method is biochemical method. In biochemical method, we do diagnostic tests in the labs. Advantages are detect early changes before the appearance of clinical signs. So, it's a disadvantage of clinical method, but advantage of biochemical method is that we can detect early changes before the appearance of clinical signs. It's precise, accurate, and reproducible. In serum protein test, we do serum calcium, vitamin B, and hemoglobin in blood, biophysical assessment including radiological examination for long bones. Such type of test we do in the lab, and we got the results. Limitations of biochemical method, it's a time consuming method. In lab, you give the specimen and next day you collect the results. Expensive, definitely. Cannot apply it on large scale. If you do a study in the community with 400 samples, it's very difficult to do a test of 400 people, especially if the test is expensive. Needs trained personnel and facilities. So, you can't do test by yourself. You need a specific person for that, you need a technician for that, and then you need a lab for that. So, these are the limitations of biochemical method. Now, what is dietary evaluation method? Again, it's a most commonly used method in social science studies, and majority of the assessments are based on this method plus BMI, which is the output of anthropometric method. In this, the dietary evaluation methods, in this, there is a list of methods. First is 24 hours dietary recall method, then food frequency questionnaire, dietary history since early life, food diary technique, and observed food consumption. In these 5 methods, 24 hours dietary recall method and food frequency questionnaire is the commonly used methods. Yes, others are also used, but less frequently. Advantages are simple questionnaires. We use very simple questionnaires for the 24 hours recall method and food frequency questionnaire. These are very simple questionnaires and easy and depends on short-term memory. So there is no chances of recall bias. Disadvantages are that questionnaires are long, although they are simple but long. Errors with estimating serving size. Needs updating with new commercial food products to keep pace with changing dietary habits. So these are the disadvantages of this method. We will discuss dietary assessment methods in more detail because these are the most commonly used method in social sciences, and also the biometric methods. Yes, we also discussed this in detail. And number 5 is energy balance. In energy balance, we see functional capacity and nutritional status and bed rest or inactivity, etc. While making the dietary plans, nutritionist will focus on this method, energy balance method. So, in social science studies, there is no specific use of this method, but in clinical side or individual level, this method is important. So out of these, as I said earlier, anthropometric method and dietary evaluation or assessment method are the most commonly used methods, and in next videos I will discuss these in details, how we can measure the different anthropometrics, and in one other video I will discuss the dietary assessment methods because these are the most commonly used methods in community-based research. Thank you for listening this video, and subscribe the channel, like it, share it. Have a nice time.